Hi, welcome to my presentation. My name is Rachel Chocron and I work in Immubit. Immubit is a startup company that does optimization control using machine learning. And my presentation will be about application state management in Jupyter applications. So here is our agenda. First, I would present the problem, state management in Jupyter application. Then I would present the common solution in frontend frameworks. Then I would present our in-house state solution. First the concept and then a code example. So what is a Jupyter application? Jupyter is a framework and it is usually used for data analysis. But we developed applications over Jupyter. Jupyter has many pre-made widgets that enable to create a UI using Python code. For the purposes of this presentation, I prepared a simple multi-pages Python application over Jupyter. It is a courses scheduling application, and it has two pages, the courses page. So that's actually a list of courses. You can add courses or remove courses, and then you have a schedule page in which you have a time column and a courses column. In the courses column, you have a dropdown for each row and you select the course you want to schedule in this time. Now, the various pages should be aware of each other data and get updates when it's changed. So for example, if I add another course, a Hebrew course, I would like that the dropdown in this rows would contain also another option, a Hebrew course. So the common solution for other front-end frameworks is a package. Other common front-end frameworks have packages for state management. For example, Redux for JavaScript. But Jupyter applications don't have a state management package. So we created our own state solution. I would present first the data flow. The diagram I would present is based on this article, which compares a few state management concepts, MVC versus Flux versus Redux. So we built a simple generic store class. The store class both holds the data we want to be shared between the various pages and also updates the pages when this data is changed. So we have two views. We have the courses view, which we would call the originating view because it's actually originating the change to the courses list. And we have another view, which is the schedule view. It would be the observing view. The originating view is triggering an action that changes the store, and the store is updating the observing view. Now I would get into implementation details. So our store has a dictionary interface. The keys are strings, and the data can be any type of data. In our case, the key is courses, the string courses, and the data is a list of courses. Now, the originating view, the courses page, when the courses list changes, it calls a function which is called invoke action with action name and payload. We would get into more details about it later. While the observing view calls a function called register callback with the key and a callback. So a few more details about the store class. It has a dictionary interface. The keys are of type string and the values can have any type of data. So now let's detail a little bit about the usage. So the first thing you have to do is register an action. So in our case, the action would be add course. You have to register an action on a specific key. In our case, the key would be courses. The action name would be add course. And you have to supply a callback that this this callback would be called when this action is invoked. Next, the originating view, the courses page in our case, should call invoke action with the action name that was already registered, add course, and the payload, which is the new course. And the observing view, which is the schedule page, should call register callback on the key courses and supply a callback to be called when the courses list is updated. We would soon see a code example of all of these. But first, let's demo how these applications actually look. So here is JupyterLab, and that's the application before using the store. So we have a courses list with three courses and the schedule page. In the schedule page, in the course column, we have a dropdown with the three possible courses. Now let's add a course. Let's add a Hebrew course. Go back to the schedule page, but the dropdown wasn't changed, still contains only three courses, which is not so good. Now let's look on the application after using our store, our state. So at first, the courses page does not contain any course. And the schedule page only contains times. The courses are empty and the dropdown is empty. Now let's add a math course and go to the schedule page, click on the dropdown. Now the dropdown contains one option, math. Let's add another course, English, for example, and go back to the schedule. Now the dropdown contains both math and English. So that's how it works in practice. Now let's go back and see how it's implemented in the code. So I would present to you three modules. The first module is the app module. So actually we use here Jupyter IPy widgets to create a tabs, two tabs with these titles. And we use the courses module and the schedule module. We initiate them and we call their function to create the grids, and we put the grids in the tab. I would not go into detail because this is more about building a Jupyter application, but note that we have a courses model and a schedule model. So this is the app module before using the store. Let's look at it after using the store. So what is the difference? First, we import the store module. Second, we initiate an instance of store, and we send a pointer in the constructor of the courses and the schedule of the store. So that's the only changes in the app module, which is the uppermost module. Now let's look about on the courses module, which is the originating view. So before using the store, in the constructor, it had a data frame and it created a QGrid widget, which is a pre-made widget from this frame, and the courses grid function returned it. Now let's see what changed with the store. So first we have an import of the store. Second, the constructor receives a pointer to the store, and the module saves it as a class member. Now there is a register action call. The register action does not have to be specifically in the originating view. It can also be in another general module that has a pointer to the store. I put it in here only to make the design a little more simple, to not show you too much modules. But actually it does not specifically connected to the courses to the courses module, and we would see this register action in the next slide. Now, the big change here is the add row function. The add row function is called on when the grid triggers a cell edited event. Then the add row function is called. What does this function do? It actually finds the name of the new added course and calls invoke action on the store with the name add course action and the new course. So this is the action being invoked, add course, and this is the payload, the new course. Now let's look in more details about the register action. So we called it on the store. What do we give it? We give it the key name, which is courses, the name of the action we are registering, which is add course, and the callback. Let's look on this callback. So this callback is a static method. It's not, doesn't have to be on a specific module. And it gets old, which is the old value of the key, and payload, which is the new payload. So actually this contains the old courses list and the new course. So what does it do? If the previous courses list is empty, so we just return a list containing only the new course. Also, we verify if the payload, if the new course is already in the list, we just return the list and we don't add anything to it. And else, we add the new course to the existing list and return the list. So that's the action add course. Now let's look on the schedule model, which is the observing view. So this is the code before using the store. So in the constructor, we have a data frame. We use QGrid again to create a grid from this data frame. And the course's schedule returns this grid in another view box, which is another detail I won't get into now. We can get into all these details in the questions if you would like. So what happens when we use the store? So we have another import. And in the constructor, the course, the schedule module also received the store. And the important thing is we have a register callback. So we register a callback on the courses key and we give it a callback called on course added. Here is the callback. So this function, what it does, it actually receives the value of the new courses list. And actually inside it updates the courses dropdown of the grid to contain the new list. So that's what this function in here is doing. So here is a link to a GitHub repo with these presentation slides, if you would like to see it again. And let's summarize what we saw. So actually we saw our problem, which was state management in Jupyter application. And we saw our solution, our in-house state solution we created to solve this problem. And we saw the concept of it and a code example of it. So we are hiring, Imubit is hiring, and we are looking for great people to join us. So look for us if you're interested. Thank you for listening, and I would be very happy to answer questions.